Interesting, because the church has a tradition saying, how do we recognize when the devil, whether it's the spirit of the devil or the spirit of Christ, which is the kind of thing you're talking about, really. The church says, if it brings peace, it's from God. If it brings chaos and turmoil, it's from the devil. Now, this is talking about personal.
But what about prophets like Ezra, who brought turmoil?
I'm sorry, who?
Who brought turmoil, who said, you know.
Good point. And we could say, what about other, what about Jeremiah and Ezekiel, who preached against the king and the ruling power? Your point is well made. So can we always tell even then? No. I think they headed right to start with.
There's no more prophets, are there, or is there?
Sure there are. We don't call them prophets anymore. No, that statement leads me to a statement by Professor Hoppe, H-O-P-P-E, who was an Old Testament professor. He was one of my teachers when I was a candidate, being a candidate. He's from Northwestern. He's Chicago. What's the seminary there? I'm sorry, I'm blanking on that, but that's where he was teaching. He said, it's a shame the church closed the canon. That is, it's a shame that the church says only what's within this book is the Word of God. He said, because of that, we tend not to hear the Word of God as contemporaries. And we omit some of the great theologians and teachers who might, how is Augusta less prophet than Jeremiah?
The church closed?
No, the church says this is it. Nothing will ever be added. This is divinity. And I got a question last week and I responded to it. And who else has the authority to make such a statement? When the Gospel according to Mary came out, Gospel according to Judas, yes. That was earlier. There was an article in Time magazine saying, is it possible that there will be, the question was, is it possible there will be added books to the Bible? Now, the secular magazine, on the back page, there was an editor, you know, back page before the cover. It was an editorial and said, absolutely not, because who has the authority to make such a statement? Nobody. Because the church has said, this is it, definitively. It said that, and it. And that's the reason a lot of the books that we think are lost got put away. They were read before Trent. And well known, some of them. Some of our people are old enough to remember being taught that when Jesus was playing with the children down by the stream, they were all making it. Birds, animals out of play. When Jesus made a bird, it flew. Notice, why was that gospel? That's the gospel of Thomas. Why was that rejected? the thoughts of that. And so that's the kind of thing that's been set. And my, have I responded to the questions?
I don't know.
I think they had already responded to the one of how do we know.
Going back to that word about a month ago, you were getting on that, and you were cut by the time you were saying that since we are like God, why do we need Jesus? Or, I still don't understand what you were trying to say.
Okay. If we are God already.
Who said that?
I
mean, literally, are you saying...
There are people who say we're God-like. We don't need a
But the
God.
Church doesn't say that.
No, of course not. Oh. No, absolutely not. But the church does say we are to become a part of God. We are a part of God. And to become Christ on earth, that's God. St. Augustine called it the document of divinization. That is, the doctrine of our being God. So, am I responding to the questions or just muddying the water?
Yeah, but he wasn't in the book.
No, he's not in the book.
But they said this is it, so what he says shouldn't...
That's not true. They teach church has then two major sources of truth. What are they?
Scripture and tradition.
Scripture and tradition. And what now is tradition? There's a little T and a capital T. Little T tradition. Okay, we go by the Holy One of Father, name the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, right? That's a little T tradition. The building won't fall down if I go past that water. We genuflect or bow before we enter the pew. Genuflect or bow toward the tabernacle. Again, lightning will strike if we just come in and sit down. These are little tea tradition.
Mm-hmm.
They're called sacramentals. Beyond my mind, beyond my lips, beyond my heart. It's a sacramental.
Well, like Jesus, he wasn't a traditional guy, because I was reading this morning that he got scolded by the Pharisees for not washing his hands before dinner, and he goes, all this tradition,
Yes and no. No. Was he a man of tradition? Oh, my, more than anybody.
He was.
Yes. But not those, what we then call sacramentals. He wasn't following. What did he say about observing the Sabbath?
Man was made for the Sabbath, not the Sabbath for... Wait, did I get this right? The Sabbath was made for man, not man made for the Sabbath.
That's right, yeah. So, yes, he's very much in the tradition, more than those people. In fact, that's exactly what we're looking at the last 2 days. We're looking at ways Jesus is a part of the tradition. Now, what is capital T, and we'll sooner or later get back to this. Capital T, tradition, okay. God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Trinity. Where does that come from?
Tradition.
That's not in the Bible. There is no mention of Trinity in the Bible. So all the people who teach Trinity are following a Catholic teaching.
Little C. Or big C.
Big D.
Big C. No, little C.
Oh,
big C.
Little C. Yeah, little C. Exactly. That's a little C Catholic teaching. But it is tradition. Many, many of our teachings are like that. That's the reason the church says scripture and tradition. Am I responding? Okay. Now, shall we go to the page that I was looking at? We have the different aspects of Jesus. And so I'm going to 68. Well, God hears the cry of the poor. The poor, okay, the remnant. Remember, Kathy, what you read?
Mm-hmm.
What did it say about the remnant?
Not to lean on.
Pardon?
They were no longer to lean on.
That's right. And they, the remnant would return. The remnant, and he uses that word. The prophets use that term again and again. So God hears the cry of the poor, the remnant. Jews who are not sons of Abraham. If you don't produce fruit as evidence of your repentance, you're not a son of Abraham. Mere blood doesn't count. After the master of the house has arisen and opened the door, then will you stand outside knocking and saying, Lord, open the door for us. You see where I am on that page? Luke 13:25.
What does that mean, produce good fruit as evidence of your repentance? In other words, you're repenting of your sins, but what is the good fruit? What is defined fruit?
Okay, it's the way they live.
In other words, if you say I'm sorry, big deal. It's you gotta like a deed. You gotta.
Yes, saying I'm sorry can be like my grandson, who was always doing something wrong. I'm telling you, and he had reprimanded me and say sorry. Sure. And when you turned his back, he did it again. Okay, I'm afraid sometimes I like that. Or again, I'm reminded of my mother-in-law's comment about this was in the day when prayer was in schools. The children would say, thank you for my mom and my dad, and thank you, Lord, for, you know. And it's about many sins, Jesus' name, amen.
What was that again?
Forgive us for our many sins in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
but they would always do it like, and forgive us for our many sins in Jesus' name. Amen. And she said, you know, if she said, we adults do that. If God says, oh, be glad to, what do you have in mind? All too often we have nothing in mind. It's like my grandson. Sorry. And then we turn around and do it again. Because we really don't even know what we're saying. Words, I like to call that not a word, a sound.
That's why it's, you know, the crucifixion on the cross, he said, Father, forgive them for they know not what they do.
That's right, it works in both ways, in that sense. Yeah.
Will Shakespeare, words without thought, never to heaven go.
Very well said.
John and I, we're doing an alpha down in at St. Louis, and it came up that the prayer, of course, yeah, I was committed adultery today, I haven't lied, I haven't swear, I haven't hurt anyone.
But I haven't
got out of
bed yet.
Yeah.
No. He definitely got out of bed. And so, like my dad, who says, I feel just like you did when I was 18. Tell him to get up. So, yeah, that's right. Or again, I'm thinking, I knew a priest was saying, you know, sometimes I'm troubled when I talk with older people who say, I don't go to confession anymore. One person said, well, Father, I haven't committed a decent sin in years.
Decent sin?
And he said, you know, what are we doing? We're forgetting that it's not what's on the outside that counts, it's what's on the inside. And so, yeah. You're just because you're descended by blood doesn't mean you are a son of Abraham. On the next page, page 70, a Gentile son of the covenant, remember? Amen, I say to you, and no one in Israel have I found such faith. And it's an everlasting covenant, and Jesus teaches resurrection. Now, let's quickly go to chapter 3 of Acts. And I'm moving toward Paul's statements. Excuse me.
I wonder how many people realize how powerful that saying is that comes from the Bible when he said, I'm not with you.
Centurion, remember, said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. And that's our response. Love that response. Okay, chapter 3, Kathy. Would you read, well, if I can get my pages turned. Would you turn to, let's see, verse 11. And this is taught, this is at the healing of the crippled man that sat, the lame man who sat at the temple, at the door of the temple. He was healed, you know. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give to you. Okay, Kathy, start at 11.
While he clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the portico, called Solomon's Portico, utterly astonished. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant, Jesus.
Excuse me. An equally correct translation would be his child, Jesus. Go ahead.
Whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses.
Okay, notice. This is firmly establishing Jesus as a true son, right? And that's Peter. All right, turn to chapter 7, same book. They just stuck together.
They all got it.
Okay, I start with verse 2, Kathy.
And Stephen replied, brothers and fathers, listen to me. The God of glory appeared to our ancestor Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before we lived in Haran, and said to him, leave your country and your relatives, and go to the land that I will show you. And he left the country of the Chaldeans and settled in Haran. After his father died, God had him move from there to this country in which you are now living. He did not give him any of it as a heritage, not even a foot's length, but promised to give it to him as his possession and to his descendants after him, even though he had no child.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to skip because he continues going through the Old Testament, if you will, and I'd like you to turn down to verse 17.
But as the time drew near for the fulfillment of the promise that God had made to Abraham, our people in Egypt increased and multiplied, until another king who had not known Joseph ruled over Egypt. He dealt craftily with our race and forced our ancestors to abandon their infants so that they would die.
Okay, now would you start skip to verse 51.
You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears.
Okay, uncircumcised in heart and ears. Where were they circumcised? You know. Mm-hmm. Okay, go ahead.
You are forever opposing the Holy Spirit, just as your ancestors used to do. Which of the prophets did your ancestors not persecute? They killed those who foretold the coming of the Righteous One. And now you have become his betrayers and murderers. You are the ones that received the law as ordained by angels, and yet you have not kept it.
Okay, notice, he's saying that they are not true sons of Abraham. Okay, by the way, when was circumcision begun?
With Abraham.
With Abraham. Before or after his statement about Abraham believed God and it was counted as righteousness. Before or after?
After.
If
these, he said they're not true sons, then what were they?
Well, hang on. I'm going to let Paul tell you. I'm sorry, not Paul. Jesus. I'm going to let Jesus tell you. Okay. Turn now to chapter 13.
Of Acts.
Of Acts, yes. Okay. Start with verse 13.
Then Paul and his companions set sail from Paphos,
the church of Antioch, and the prophets and teachers.
27. I'm sorry. Did I say verse 13?
Yeah.
Chapter 13, verse 26.
My brothers, you descendants of Abraham's family, and others who fear God, to us, the message of this salvation has been sent, because the residents of Jerusalem and their leaders did not recognize him or understand the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. They fulfilled those words by condemning him. Even though they found no cause for a sentence of death, they asked Pilate to have him killed.
Okay, skip then to verse 32.
And we bring you the good news that what God promised to our ancestors, he has fulfilled for us, their children.
Okay. Now, these three quotations in Acts, one was from Peter, one was from Stephen, one was from Paul. Notice that as Luke presents it, they all have essentially the same message. Now I'd like you to go to Galatians, and Paul's going to tell you something about who the children are. Turn to Galatians see, this is, this will be a good work. Galatians chapter 3, and start with verse.
Is that in the New Testament?
Yes, that's the New Testament. It's after the Gospel account and Acts and Romans and 1 Corinthians, then Galatians. Okay. Let's see. Start with verse 27. I'm sorry, wait a minute. That's not what I meant to give you.
It's already 24 here.
Yeah, that's right. Galatians chapter 3, verse 6. That's where I meant to take you.
Just as Abraham believed God, it was reckoned to him as righteousness. So you see, those who believe are the descendants of Abraham.
Notice, who is a descendant of Abraham? Those who have faith, literally. Faith is an active verb in Greek. We have the word believe, but it's not quite the same as faith, is it? But that's the best we can do. They faith God is what it is in the Greek. Go ahead, Kathy.
And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, declared the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the Gentiles shall be blessed in you.
Remember, that's straight past Abraham, right?
Mm-hmm.
Keep reading.
For this reason, those who believe are blessed with Abraham who believed.
Okay. Who now is a child of Abraham, a son of Abraham?
Everybody
who believes, Jew and Gentile. Okay. Now I want you to move to chapter 4. And this is not an easy passage, and I'm not asking you to think it through carefully. But this is one of the ways Paul teaches. Chapter 4, verse 21.
Tell me, you who desire to be subject to the law, will you not listen to the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a slave woman and the other by a free woman. One, the child of the slave, was born according to the flesh. The other, the child of the free woman, was born through the promise. Now, this is an allegory. These women are two covenants. One woman, in fact, is Hagar from Mount Sinai, bearing children for slavery. Now, Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and corresponds to the present Jerusalem, where she is in slavery with her children. But the other woman corresponds to the Jerusalem above. She is free, and she is our mother. For it is written, rejoice, you childless one, you who bear no children. Burst into song and shout, you who endure no birth pangs.
Okay, now, notice what you got here. Abraham had two sons. Son by free woman, son by slave woman. Which is the older? Ishmael. As opposed to Isaac. Notice, this one was born according to the flesh. This one according to the promise. This one is like the present-day Jerusalem, and when Paul wrote this, present-day Jerusalem was still standing. All the Jerusalem above. You see the contrast? That's the kind of writing that was very, very popular. Allegory. That continued to be popular all the Guinness. In some ways it still is.
Why did the people then, with all their knowledge, reject what was being told them?
Okay, good question. Why did people reject the words of the prophets?
Because it says a prophet is never respected by
people. They didn't trust the prophet, they didn't believe it. Again, same reason.
Why do we sin today?
Why are there people today who are not accepting our faith?
Is there an evil power, the devil, like one shoulder and good on the other, like they're still fighting over us?
That's not a bad allegory. You've just given.
Yeah. It's a parable.
Yeah. We have both. We always have that. Once we are baptized, is that the end of our sinning? Absolutely not. That's the difference between us and the Blessed Mother. Our baptism is our Immaculate Conception. Trouble is, we don't stay clean. Okay, now will you go with me to Romans? Book of Romans, chapter 3. That's where I was looking at when I said 27. Romans, chapter 3.
Where's Romans?
Romans is back the other way. Back the other way. Romans, chapter 3. And start with verse 27, Kathy. Yes.
Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works, prescribed by the law. Or is it God, the God of Jews only? Is it not the God of Gentiles also?
You know why he says that, don't you? He's already said Galatians was written before Romans. Go ahead.
Yes, of Gentiles also, since God is one, and he will justify the circumcised on the ground of faith, and the uncircumcised through that same faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. Go on. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness.
Okay, I would like to interrupt just long enough to say Romans 3:23 says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of the wages of sin is death, but the
gift of eternal life.
It's Romans 6:23, not 3:23. The wages of sin is death, but the gift.
God is eternal life.
But the gift of God is eternal life. Thank you. By the way, I have asked people to let me know if I'm getting so confused, because this is what happens sometimes. as, so thank you for keeping me straight. Okay, and so Wages, that's sixth chapter, not third chapter. Go ahead, Kathy. Verse 9, was it?
No, 6. I'm on 6 now. So also David speaks of the blessedness of those to whom God reckons righteousness apart from works.
Oh, by the way, righteousness can also be translated as justice. That's right. Okay, go ahead.
Blessed are those whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one against whom the Lord will not reckon sin.
By the way, that's a quotation from Psalm 32. Go ahead.
Is this blessedness, then, pronounced only on the circumcised or also on the uncircumcised? We say, faith was reckoned to Abraham as righteousness. How then was it reckoned to him? Was it before or after he had been circumcised?
You see where I got my question? Go ahead.
It was not after, but before he was circumcised. He received the sign of circumcision as a seal of the righteousness that he had by faith while he was still uncircumcised. The purpose was to make him the ancestor of all who believed without being circumcised, and who thus have righteousness reckoned to them. And likewise, the ancestor of the circumcised, who are not only circumcised, but who also follow the example of the faith that our ancestor Abraham had before he was circumcised.
Okay. Notice this is strictly what we would expect him to say, right? All right. Now, we'll turn to chapter 9 of Romans. And I'm going to skip parts of this, but just touch on some verses here. Verse 9, chapter 1.
I am speaking the truth in Christ.
Oh, I'm sorry. 38, chapter 8, verse 38. And then going over to 9. Verse 38 of chapter 8.
For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, our Lord. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all. God bless forever. Amen.
Okay. Now would you skip to verse 11. I'm sorry, chapter 11, verse 1.
Verse 1?
Mm-hmm.
Hi, yes.
Could you turn the heat up just a little bit?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Kathy, chapter 11, verse 1.
I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin.
Okay. Now we'll just skip to chapter 11, verse 11.
So So I ask, have they stumbled so as to fall?
Who is the they?
The Jewish.
The Jews. Go ahead.
By no means. But through their stumbling, salvation has come to the Gentiles, so as to make Israel jealous.
Okay, skip to verse 25.
So that you may not claim to be wiser than you are, brothers and sisters, I want you to understand this mystery. A hardening has come upon part of Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved.
Ah, had you ever heard that before? Mm-hmm. So all Israel will be saved. Notice?
That's like the end of the world, at the end of this time, or
this
hasn't happened yet.
There is, and there's no statement about when it will happen. That's God's own time, remember, today, the name of the Lord is as a thousand years as a day. Okay, now we're going to move to Hebrews, chapter 2. Hebrews is toward the end of the Old Testament, not far before.
Which chapter?
It's near the Revelation, near the end of the. Chapter 2.
And verse
16. I'll start with 14.
Since, therefore, the children share flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same things.
The he is Jesus.
So that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death.
By the way, did you notice that? One of the reasons Jesus came was to free us from
the fear of death. For it is clear that he did not come to help angels, but the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested.
So when you believe that Jesus was the Son of God, that's like a tremendous act of faith. You don't have no fear of death, meaning you're in, right? That's a pretty powerful statement. I mean,
depends on how you understand that statement, Dave. There are a lot of people who say, yeah, I believe that Jesus is God, and they live like the devil.
Yeah, but they still believe. Why make the simple complicated?
Okay, I'm going to skip immediately to James, the second chapter. That's the next book over. Right next to it. Chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 14. We'll start reading, Kathy.
What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but you do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and what if you say to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill? And yet you do not supply their bodily needs. What is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I by my works will show you my faith. You believe that God is one, you do well. even the demons believe and shudder.
Notice, you believe that Jesus is God, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. So simply say, I trust that Jesus is God.
So we can never relax. We always have to keep striving. I mean, you never know when you're in. You
we can absolutely relax with the idea that we're freed by Jesus Christ.
But you have to walk the walk.
Not to talk. Not to earn salvation.
No,
it's
but...
It's a gift.
But you just contradicted what you're...
No. Okay. This is not absolute, but I think it will address it somewhat. In Judaism, act right, and you will be right, or righteous, if you will, act righteous. You, Christianity, be right, and you will act right. Now, I put word choice, but do you follow the idea? Okay, Judaism says if you act in a certain way, that becomes a part of you, and it becomes a part of who you are. Christianity says, get the core taken care of, and everything else should take care of itself. So, you don't work in order to be saved, in order to stay in, if I could put it like that. You do what you do because of what is within you. You're not thinking, oh, gotta get this one, gotta get this one, gotta get this one. So, thank God you can't you cannot condemn me because look at what I've done. Isn't that what people said to Jesus? Lord? We heard you on our streets, we ate and drank with you. He said, I don't know where you come from. Depart from me, you evil loons. So, Judaism, at the time of Jesus, and I'm talking about now, Judaism at the time of Jesus said, okay, if you do all these, I don't know, wash your hands. You mentioned this to start with. That's ritual washing. Not washing for sanitation. All the kind of sacramentals, the idea was if you do these, then they will become so much a part of you that you are in relationship with God.
It's like when you said to the Pharisees, you're white on the outside but black on the inside. So in other words, if you find yourself giving $20 instead of your usual $10, you're fooling yourself. It's gotta come from here, and it just gotta be.
Well, I think I say giving your usual $10. You think that's going to make sure that God can't condemn you? No. Now, one of the things that is also important, and this is church teaching, is okay. The best response of all is to love God single-mindedly. But very few, if any of us, can do that single-mindedly. I'm reminded of what my oldest daughter said after she went to Africa and was teaching in a mission school. She said, I have become aware that I wanted to do this for the wrong reason. I wanted to go to Africa and teach in a mission school so that people could say, look what a good person she is. That won't get it. And she knew that. Or it's like Archbishop Cusero said, I became a priest for all the wrong reasons. I suspect he was overstating it, as my daughter was. But notice, it's so hard for us to do something single-minded with God. But that's what we're called to. That's what he's been called to Jesus. Because we're not there yet for sure. This is my sister's.
How that she has fallen back on that experience many times through her life.
And so have her parents. So have her parents, because I said after she was in Africa, she became our spiritual director. Because
that's interesting.
She was working through so many, many things. And in other words, doing what we all are supposed to be doing. Not getting our grounding points with God, no, but getting our hearts and minds and consciences. And in the words of the Bible, our bowels in relationship to God. Everything within us, in other words. Okay. Now, I would like to go, and I think this may be a good time to do it, because we've just got about 10 minutes. And Dave, I missed the passage that tells you who the father of those were. But I'll tell you what Paul says, what Jesus says. You are of your father, the devil, because you're trying to kill me. And the devil is a killer, is a murderer, he says, and a liar. And you are trying to kill me. You are of your father, the devil.
Would you go back who was saying that to
the Jews? Jesus was saying that to the Jews who were hostile Jews. And I forgot that I to include that. I meant to earlier. And so I'm going to have that in the handout for next time. But would you go with me to chapter 11 of Hebrews? And that's where we'll stop. Then we're going to move to the covenant of David. Notice how many ways the covenant of Abraham is used, referred to and alluded to so many times. Okay, chapter 11. Now, I'd like you to start with verse 39 of chapter 10. We're going to read chapter 11, but start with chapter 10, 39.
Okay. Well, we are not among those who shrink back and so are lost, but among those who have faith and are so saved.
Notice, those who shrink back from faith are lost. So start again and then continue. 39 again.
But we are not among those who shrink back and so are lost, but among those who have faith and so are saved. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen.
Okay, notice, if we see it, it's not faith. Things hoped for. We all tend to want an ironclad assurance, right? Do you see why Father Beck did not say, "I know"?
You gotta persevere.
It's a matter of constantly working on what's inside, not talking about folks on the outside.
Never give up.
Never give up. he didn't give up on us. So.
Well, it's not, we're not over yet.
That's true. We are a work in progress, always. We're in purgatory right now. Make good use of it.
Is that right, like, 2 seconds before you die, if you make a good act of contrition?
You know what? That's about the most foolish thing I've ever heard of.
Yeah.
Is that possible?
Yes.
I wouldn't bank on it.
I like what you said, John. Don't take a chance.
It's true. Yeah.
What did you say, Rita?
John said, why take the chance?
I'll take the chance.
Yeah. And, you know, I wonder if that's not like my grandson David when we deliberately plan that kind of thing. Oh, I'll say the magic words just before I die. No, I don't think so. Oh, that reminds me of what children went to a training union session in my mother's church, the Baptist church, and the lesson was on the meaning of communion. And one of the things it said was, Catholics believe that communion is a magic pill. And they were three upset young people. But, yeah, the magic word and the magic pill, sorry, not one of those either way. So go ahead now, Candy, start again with chapter 11, verse 1.
Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that were not visible.
Notice what is, so that what was, so that what is seen was made from things not seen, in effect. Mm-hmm. Okay? And here's, he's giving examples of this now. What was seen is an indication of what we don't see. Verse 8, skip to verse 8.
By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going.
And that is strictly straight from Genesis. That's right, go ahead.
By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, he received power of procreation, even though he was too old. And Sarah herself was barren, because he considered himself faithful, who had promised.
Notice, Abraham is the absolute perfect place to begin when you talk about somebody who had faith. Old, away from all family, with an old, barren wife. God, come on. She'll have a child. Do you follow? That seems so absolutely impossible. Can't be anything but faith. Go ahead, Kathy.
Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead.
You understand why I say that? As good as dead. Go ahead.
Descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven, and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith, without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth.
And that's what we are supposed to be. Skip to verse 17, please.
By faith, Abraham, when put to the test, offered up Isaac. He who had received the promises was ready to offer up his only son, of whom he had been told, It is through Isaac that descendants shall be named for you. He considered the fact that God is able even to raise someone from the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive him back.
By the way, I think I told you that was a favorite passage for early Christians. The story of Abraham and Isaac, because they understood it as a promise of resurrection. Okay, I think maybe that's a place to stop, but you can see that the people of the New Testament and the early church were teaching using what we call the Old Testament and other books as the sacred tradition. And remember, the Gospels had not been written, or even if they had been written, they were not circulating much by this time. So, if you, I asked one young evangelical who was talking with me about how important the Bible was. I said, that's true, the Bible is very important. And one of our great teachers named Jerome said ignorance of the Bible, ignorance of what he's talking about over the New Testament, is ignorance of Christ. But hundreds of years passed, thousands of years passed, before people could read the Bible, and before there was even a Bible that served in a book to be read. So, we are not so much people of the book as the book comes out of a faithful people. Does that make sense? Can you say it again? Let me put it differently. This is not mine, of course. Jesus didn't come to write a book. He came to form a community. He didn't write a thing that we have preserved. That's the reason we refer to our apostolic church. And so, yeah, the book is important. I would agree with Jerome, in the sense that if we haven't heard the book or read the book, then that's ignorance of Christ. But the faith and the community come first.
Which is why I never understood why the church did not foster our reading of the Bible.
Interesting. Councilor Trent, the statement was, if you read the Bible every day, you receive a plenary indulgence. So Trent certainly encouraged it, but it didn't get to us. And of course, what is important about Vatican II, and I'm convinced that Pope John Lucas, was that it has to come to the people, or it doesn't make it. It has to be. And again and again and again, I'm reminded of what we as deacons were taught. Vatican II occurred to say, grow up. You're not children. And along with this, of course, is the infallibility of one's conscience. But you better be careful, because conscience can be malformed. And the church says that too. So it's always both and yes, but. shall we pray? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Father, we are truly grateful to you for your word written and for your word lived here to show us how pray, Father, that we may never presume on your mercy, but always be grateful for it. Guide us, especially those most in need. We pray in the name of Lord Jesus. I wrote this cross today. I looked at it a long time. One of my former students made this, and her fingerprints are on the cross.
Oh, okay.
So she made it, you see, but the symbols are still hot enough. So it's a real treasure.
Yeah, I did.